these unusual manuscripts, the differences become clear. Every page suggests a rethinking of what we know about Jesus Christ. For the first time, we follow in the footsteps of Christ the child, and even the rebellious young teenager. Experts believe these texts are authentic ancient documents. But what they mean may be challenged forever. Every lost text about Jesus is filled with surprises. One manuscript, the Infancy Gospel of Thomas, is a startling collection of tales showing an immature child wielding supernatural powers.
The Infancy Gospel of Thomas begins with a scene with Jesus by a stream playing in the water and in the mud.
Jesus, playing in the mud, shows himself to be this creator, much as God himself played in the mud in Genesis and created the first human being.
But at the riverbank, Jesus doesn't form Adam in his own image. He creates something completely different.
He starts forming some sparrows out of the mud. And as he's doing this, a Jewish man walks by and sees what he's doing and gets upset because it's the Sabbath day. So Jesus is violating the Sabbath. He's working on the Sabbath. This is, of course, foreshadowing what's going to happen later on in his life when he gets into these controversies over Sabbath observance. Well, the man runs off to tell Jesus' father what he's done, and Joseph comes into the scene, and he sees his son there. He sees these sparrows made out of the mud and gets angry and says, "Jesus, what have you done? You violated the Sabbath."
Jesus responds by clapping his hands, and the clay pigeons take flight and fly away.
It is the first miracle described in this gospel, a story meant to illustrate the mystical, godlike abilities within Jesus the child.
He's destroyed all evidence of malfeasance, and so it shows that Jesus can create life, so that he in fact has divine power in him, and it resolves the problem of him working on the Sabbath, that he in fact is the Lord of the Sabbath, even as a five-year-old boy.
What comes next in the Infancy Gospel of Thomas is almost beyond belief. This gospel claims the Son of God is capable of taking life.
He has a temper, kind of a bad temper. And when Jesus gets mad, watch out, because he's got some real wallop in his temper.
According to this text, Jesus cripples the young son of the man who complained about Jesus violating the Sabbath, saying,
"You also shall be like a tree without root and not bear fruit," and the child then withers in his presence. The child's parents come and kind of carry the withered one away, bemoaning his lost youth, wondering what kind of child is this who can curse somebody like this.
This gospel relates other unsettling incidents about the young Jesus, a boy who's not only powerful, but quick to anger.
As Jesus is walking through the street in his hometown, Nazareth, and another child accidentally bumps into his shoulder, and this irritates Jesus. He turns to the kid and says, "You'll go no further on your way."
The Infancy Gospel claims the boy struck by Jesus falls to the ground, dead.
Why would Christians want to portray Jesus as violent, as somebody who killed people or withered people? And I'm not sure that there's a good answer to it.
Some experts, three times in the Infancy Gospel of Thomas, young Jesus performs the same miracle he later does as an adult. He raises the dead. The first incident comes when Jesus' playmate, Zenon, falls from a roof. The people of Nazareth, already afraid of this violent Jesus, mistakenly believe he killed the boy.
There's Zenon down on the ground, and Zenon's parents walk up right at that second. They see their dead child. They see Jesus on the roof. They think, "Yeah, he's been doing it again."
They accuse Jesus. "Troublemaker, you threw him down." Jesus replied, "I did not throw him down. rather he threw himself down. When he was not acting carefully, he leaped off the roof and died.
Well, everybody in the village thinks that Jesus must have done it because he's been smiting the children of the village who annoy him.
Brothers were so dangerous that for hundreds of years the church fathers refused to include them in the Bible. They were only finally accepted because the oral traditions concerning Jesus' family were so strong.
There were some Christian leaders who said, well, James, I don't know if we should include him. Now, he's the brother of Jesus. Why wouldn't you want his letter? Because if you read the letter, it doesn't have the gospel that people came to associate with Christianity.
In complete contrast to today's Christianity, the letters of Jesus' brothers describe him as their master, but not divine. They see Jesus as a human character blessed by God.
The thing about the book of James, it's the teachings of Jesus, but not the teachings about Jesus. James passes on what he got from his brother. You could say it has no theology.
The seventh stage.
And yet it does have a theology, but it's the theology of Jesus. But it's no theology about Jesus in that book. Doesn't mention the cross of Christ. Doesn't mention the blood of Jesus. Doesn't mention forgiving sins through believing in the Lord, our Savior, who's in heaven. Nothing like that. It's an amazing book to read.
This alternative version of Jesus' message can be found in other texts too. In the Greek quarter of the old city of Jerusalem, there is another ancient book that was not included in the Bible. It's one of the most contested of early Christian documents, possibly even older than the Gospels themselves. I believe it is the key to understanding Jesus' original message.
I'm very sorry that the library is not in its proper situation.
The Library of the Greek Patriarch has the only complete copy of an ancient handbook specially written for converts to Christianity that was compiled when Jesus' family was still alive. The Didache gives a direct insight into what the very earliest Christians thought and did. It has never before been filmed.
Can I hold it?
Yes.
Wow. This is like being close to the early church.
Of course.
Wow. And I'm not using gloves, is that okay?
It's okay. I'm not using this one.
Yes. Wow.
The book begins here. Although Dio isi, mia tu zois ke mia tu thanatu. There are two ways, one of the life and one of the death.
The Didache, or teaching, contains a code of Christian ethics based on the original teachings of Jesus, and some instructions as to the proper forms of worship.
Διαφορά πολύ μεταξύ των δύο οδών. There is a great difference between the two ways.
But what makes it so dangerous for today's Christianity is what it leaves out. There is no mention of the virgin birth, no mention of the resurrection, and above all, no mention of Jesus as God.
They talk of Jesus in here as Lord and not Lord God, suggesting that they saw him as being more human than divine. How does that strike you?
In my opinion, in the evangelists, in the gospels, and in the works of apostles, there is a balance between the presentation of Christ as the Son of God and as the Son of Man. The Lord to whom we believe is divine, but he is human.
And that's the problem. For 2,000 years, the church has grappled with the balance between Jesus' divine and human natures. But it is the divine that has dominated. In the process, it is Jesus' essential humanity and the humanity of his teachings that has been lost. The Didache also contains a detailed description of a very early communion service. Unlike today, there is no suggestion that the bread and wine are the body and blood of Christ. In fact, Jesus is referred to not as God's Son, but his servant.
And concerning the broken bread, we thank you, our Father, for the life and knowledge which you made known to us through Jesus, your servant. To you belongs the glory forever.
Do you think that one of the reasons why they don't mention Jesus as Lord God and they don't mention the resurrection was because they didn't believe that those events had taken place, that Jesus wasn't the Son of God and that Jesus wasn't raised from the dead, but instead he was a human, a prophet, and not divine? It's a dangerous question.
In my opinion, the fact of the resurrection of Christ couldn't and shouldn't be ignored. Paul speaks and says, if Christ was not resurrected, then we shall be accused that we speak falsely against God.
What is absolutely fundamental to all Christians, including myself, is the idea that Jesus is God. Without that, there is no Christianity. But what is now clear is that the very earliest Jewish Christians, including Jesus' own family, did not see him as God. And ultimately, that is why the church has gone so far to delete them from the Christian story.
This is Judas, the brother of the Lord according to the flesh.
Jude,
who has written in it.
In the Bible, in the letter of Jesus' younger brother Jude, there is an extraordinary passage denouncing a group of people who are secretly corrupting the true faith.
For admission has been secretly gained by some who long ago were designated for this condemnation, ungodly persons who pervert the grace of our God.
If you decode it, it becomes a clear warning that the new movement was losing sight of Jesus' original message.
By the time Jude writes, he could see the writing on the wall. He could see we're losing out. And it's a battle cry. It's a call to arms, spiritually speaking. He's not talking about outsiders. He's talking about people who claim to be part of us that are not teaching what we were originally handed down.
These are grumblers, malcontents, following their own sinful desires. They are loud-mouthed boasters, flattering people to gain advantage.
And he's getting very worried. And he's telling the little group that would still listen to him. I think in effect he's saying, don't listen to all these new things that are coming along. You fight hard for that original faith that was delivered to us. Family tradition. Follow the tradition of the family. Almost a mute testimony to what used to be the way.
When Constantine the Great made Christianity the official religion of the Roman Empire 1600 years ago, it was Paul's interpretation of Jesus' message that was adopted. And Paul based his authority on a series of mystical visions, although he had never met Jesus and only joined the movement after his death. By contrast, James and the rest of the family who had grown up with Jesus, followed his mission, and been at his death, their version of Christianity, a vision of Jesus as a more human character, was declared heresy.
Now, what you need to ask yourself is, why is the life of Jesus missing from the age of 30 to 33? It's obvious, isn't it? Someone meant to hide their childhood years. Here, the picture they wanted to portray was the divine one. And including his childhood years just causes a bit of a problem, doesn't it? So, why not just leave the whole thing out altogether? Secondly, all his disciples had their own Bibles, including his family. But, including them, the people who walked, ate, slept, lived with Jesus, the church decided, no, we'll just leave them out altogether, leave them out of the picture. I mean, the brother of Jesus tells you why. So there are those who are corrupting the true teachings of Jesus. And that happened at the time of the disciples. Imagine that. Now, it all comes down to what you believe in, really. There are those who are ignorant and still choose to toss aside the teachings of Jesus and carry on following Paul, the guy who rejected the teachings of Jesus. But there are many who are true believers who love Jesus and will seek the truth. The ones who would still choose to follow Paul, rejecting Jesus, will know the full extent of the choice on the day of judgment. But bear in mind, when you die, that's it, mate, you're gone. And that you ain't gonna get another chance. You can't say to God that I was following Paul, he was the one who taught me. People say, I sent my messenger, Jesus, but he decided to follow Paul. Imagine if you're wrong. It's a life and hellfire. Seems like a huge gamble. Mate, I want to be there. One deserves to be looked into. It's a life for good or bad. We don't want to be a loser, mate. And getting doomed in hellfire for eternity. Think about it. In judgment, my those who go up to Jesus and say, Lord, Lord, did we not prophesy in your name? Cast out demons in your name? Perform many miracles? Guess what Jesus will say to him? He will say, I never knew you. Away from here, you evildoers. This is what Jesus will say. Life short, people. Life short, certainly not to be gambled with. I pray everyone chooses the right path and makes the right choice. Path to heaven. Peace be to you, guys.